Hello, everyone. I have a mug of coffee in my hands, and let's do this. So I have spent the past couple of years watching some people on YouTube to try to get back into watercolor because I have so much of it and a lot of my tubes actually started to dry, but I still have a palette. I will link some of the ones in the description that were the most helpful to me. And here I think I'm mostly practicing with grades. I'm practicing my mark making or my strokes. I know mark making is more of a drawing term. But I'm playing around with these new brushes I got. I'll have them listed at the end, but they were a recommendation from another watercolor YouTuber. And I'm practicing stuff. I'm actually seeing what painting onto wet paper looks like, what it looks like with dry, giving the brush a few strokes on some paper towel to see what dry brushing looks like, and experimenting with the wash that I'll be using later for the final. Apologies in advance for the low quality on a couple of these. Our power company decided after a storm and the worst heat wave of the summer, like there was not a hotter day the entire summer, to cut the power to our house, so I was dealing with slowly waning lighting. But here we are basically starting with the construction of the robes that the characters will be wearing. Isabella, I think she's in three basic robes that we do see in layers. And there's just kind of like this sheer one on top that I was practicing with the black and bronze earlier in the watercolor practice stage. The one I had the most issues with was Perry, the male. A lot of his stuff was just coming out almost over the top or goofy looking or campy or something. I did kind of want to pay homage to his Romanesque background, hence the toga, though it makes him look a bit more like an orator and a senator than some sort of person getting ready for a ritual. But once he was done, I was able to start exploring the props that I wanted in here. The painting itself is based on another painting called Edward Burne Jones's The Wizard for Comics vs. Art, and I wanted to include some of those elements while also putting my own spin on them. And that includes a lamp that also has a sensor attached to it among scrolls instead of books. Now at the drawing phase, we do have a little cushion time to talk about the show itself. Comics vs. Art is on its fifth year, and I've submitted something for each year. The last one back in 2019 was the charcoal drawing that I actually did with the webcam way back in the day. That feels like so long ago. Well, it was. But I did get Edward Burne Jones's The Wizard. There was a ton of cool art in there that I found really inspiring, but this one was what my friends and I decided would be the most doable, because we're basically taking classical art and reinterpreting it. But here I'm kind of using my table and a ruler. I'm getting perspective lines down. I'm trying to work really light, but I'm also using a very hard graphite. The graphite and this paper don't really seem to like each other, but I think I'm purposefully using one of my cheaper watercolor papers so I can get those out of here back before I knew that you really wanted to get the heavier stuff for actual watercolor painting. But if the faces get really messed up later, it's really bad. But I do feel really proud of myself that I picked a perspective point based on the original paintings, and put down the table. I remembered the little stand for the sensor. I think I called it cistern earlier. Whoops. But Isabella's holding the lamp. We have the stairs coming in. I'm very loosely adding the figures. I'm very loosely adding little effects to the room and such. I'm trying to consider the watercolor phase before we get to it. And I'm, as you can see, I'm possibly slowly incorporating softer LEDs, getting darker lines. I did want to trace this, but I find later that the papers are too thick for my LED strip, or the LED strip just needs a little TLC or something, like maybe they're still not compact enough. And I'm working the figures in, trying to work on the faces. Perry's was oddly easy for me. Isabella's gave me the most trouble. I've always had issues with angled faces, but I have the scroll in. I'm making a box for the other scrolls, which might have been a late addition, but I'm glad I put it in there. It helped kind of make things a bit more believable. And we're mostly building the room. So the first little bit here was me possibly in vain trying to trace the drawing from the original paper onto what will be my final watercolor paper. I did work with one of the softer pencils I could find. This is actually from a Ben Krefta How to Draw Manga kit that I got way back in, at the age of 12 or 13 or something. And it was a big push in the right direction for me. Though I did notice I think I started getting a little static at that time too, which was a bit of a problem. But anyway, I wanted to start with the two cloaked figures at the top of the stairs. There is a painting, I will link to it in the description, of, I do believe it is an anime industry background artist working with poster paint, but a lot of the techniques I think would apply. And there was something about the way they made the sunbeam. I really wanted to do it so bad, and I had my opportunity here. But from there, I do just kind of start going with the large washes, working my way towards the table, the floor. I wanted to leave the characters, well, Izzy and Perry, for last, to make sure I didn't paint over them or anything by accident after I did all this stuff. But I think I only wetted the paper when I was working on large areas because I wanted the color to bleed. Which, I was looking at a Australian, I think, watercolor artist who, I'll link to his playlist in the description as well. It was very helpful for me. And there's another watercolor artist that was talking about the different consistencies of your tinted water that I will link to as well. I might try to remember to put a title up. There it is. And I encourage you to check those out because they were very, very helpful with this and giving me the confidence to do this. Though I do feel like I almost worked too thin, especially starting out. Like I was afraid of making something too dark, but if you do recall from a previous one I had done, I think I started too dark and I didn't give myself that chance to layer anything effectively. My one regret is I don't think I gave stuff long enough to dry, and that meant especially for the cloaked figures above, stuff kind of got muddy together and all of these colors that I tried laying down to give this nice effect, I'm not really sure pulled through. Which I do believe if I got some arches or some other paper, I do really want to try this one again. It's just maybe come back to it after I have some other stuff done. But we are slowly working on, I think I gave the most love to the table of all things. It was very bizarre, but I did notice in the original, the Burne Jones original, the people, like, I don't even know if you would know they were there if it weren't for their faces, because their robes were so, they weren't the same color as the room around them, but they were the same values, which means that they were at about the same light value as the rest of the room. So they just kind of blend in, and I think the point of that was to try to make the room and everything inside of it, the books on the table, the little accessories, the jars, the one thing that's burning, the porthole, make those the central part of the work. But for this, I was trying to make something character focused but still have some of those flavor props in there, if that makes any sense, to be like, so yeah, something's going down, because you may notice the environment doesn't exactly match up with the people. So what's with these scrolls and everything? And if I do get around to getting the story written, it will make a lot more sense. Or I hope it will. But we are to the people now, and I think that's another thing of, I didn't give them enough time between adding the folds and stuff, though I did want to really make the robes dark to have them just stand out in this light and bright room that I made, along with the cloaked figures, which I tried adding more purple to over time. And to get some of those blushes in there, I think I made little droplets of water first, and then put a little bit of my crimson down and let it bleed. But Perry's robe, everyone's like, oh my gosh, his shroud there looks fantastic. I'm like, I put so much work into that. But I think getting the right color again was the biggest pain in the butt for his robes. But I am glad about the skin shades. It was crimson, yellow, and blue, if I remember correctly. But thank you so much for following me on this little journey. I do feel inspired to continue working more in watercolor and improving my craft. It was a little aggravating at times, but I hope you enjoyed these little shots of the bronze ink, showing off the bronze ink that I did. I wished that it showed up a little better in the outermost robes, so I can probably always touch up better on that again later. And I also learned quite a bit about my video program, trying to make sure the lighting was a little more even and everything. But without further ado, I'll get into my materials a little bit more. I know we're a bit ahead on that, but the star players here were the transcend round brushes that I got from the Reddit Secret Santa a couple of years ago, along with a Princeton brush that I've had around for ages. Other than that, it was a lot of Prussian blue, Alizarin crimson, lemon yellow, and the umbers nobody knows how to cook. And then a Faber Castell watercolor pad and my usual drawing materials. Thank you so much again for watching. I'll see you next time.